Yeah. Hiya, everyone. Still conversation. My talk is about Push, like it's not 1999. I don't know if they had any Push in 1999, but it was a nice, nice title, eh? But everyone is here. That's first talk about me. That's my Twitter. It's my name is too long to be a Twitter handle, so I shortened it to that. That's the longest name you can get. I'm Nick. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a developer. I also have horses. That's something different. I do PHP development now for like 11 years, so I know a little bit about it. But this talk is not all about PHP. If you don't, if you want PHP, you can do anything else. Our gift with this talk is I was in a company, and we needed some push mechanism because we have an auction website. We started building an auction website, and then performs bidding of users, and all the bids are in the last second, and it takes microseconds to decide which bid was the final bid. So we needed some real-time updates of the latest bids, and so we started looking, and first time we had like the flash objects. You have a flash object in your page, hidden, and then a messaging server or something like that. And then you just put in some data, and then with JavaScript you pulled it out, your flash object, and then you had some notification or something like that on your website. But yeah, who's using flash right now? So that was not what we did. We tried polling, but yeah, it's the last second, so you don't know. Are you correct on time, and it takes some latency? So yeah, polling was also another option. Try the long polling, just like start it in press and just wait till we get some data. That could be, but it takes a lot of memory on your server to do this. So we needed like, let's say 600 people on one auction, and it took like 10 gigabytes of memory to perform this. So yeah, I don't have that amount of money, so let's skip that. Then we also had the streams, the forever iframe. It's just a hidden iframe performing requests or like long calling. But yeah, it's still not what you want, because you want push data and not fast data. So we come up with WebSockets. The thing with WebSockets is it's bidirectional, so the client can also put in data, and you can get data. And the problem is it's just on protocol. So yeah, you have a special server or something like that for that. And we only need to push the latest bits. So we didn't need the bidirectional stuff. And then we came up with event source. It's also called server sent events. Anyone heard of it? Okay. So it's one direction, it's over HTTP, and it reconnects on disconnect. So if the client disconnects, it automatically reconnects. So we were like, yes, we have it. So we started. This is how you set up an event source in JavaScript. So it's basically check if we have an event source object, and then create one to whatever file you want.
What is the implementation on the first
thing? Yeah. That's just, it's checking if it's there.
Perhaps you have double negation.
The magic cast off the boolean in JavaScript.
Yeah. So it's not the undefined
stuff.
And then we add a listener on the message. That's the event. It's for the event source. And when we get an event, we just console log it right now. How does an event source tool look like? First, as a server, you have to respond with HTTP content type text event stream, and then you can just put in lines of data, and every line starts with data, and then with whatever line you want. And to end your message, you put in a blank line. So if you want to do multiple lines because you have more data, you just say data, hello, HTTP component, new line, data, where's the beer? And then put in an empty line. And then that message will be sent. But you can do more with it. Because you can also put in JSON. Just start with data, and then JSON open, and put in your parameters, and then close with a new line. And on your JavaScript, you can just parse it. So you have a full JSON object in your JavaScript as a message. And then you can do whatever you want with it. Event sourcing also supports IDs. And this is really nice, because you just put in, before sending the event, an ID string with the ID of the message, and then your message. And then when the client disconnects and reconnects, it can send a header that's called lost event ID. And when it gives that, it's just, let's say, 1,000, the server knows, okay, this was my last ID, so I have to give also 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004 to keep up with the other clients. And you can also say, what's the reconnect time? Basically, normally, if you have a standard event source, it's like 3 seconds. So if a client disconnects, it retries it in 3 seconds. But from the server, you can say, okay, I want to have it on 10 seconds. Just add retry 10,000 milliseconds. And then the client will try to reconnect in 10 seconds with whatever information you want. You can also do custom events. That's by adding event, and then the event name, and then your data. So on your JavaScript, you add a new listener on that event name, and only those events are coming into your JavaScript project. But then we came up with browser support. And then it was like, fuck. Because all browsers support event source, except Internet Explorer. Okay, and that's why
Internet Explorer 5.5 doesn't support much, you know?
Yeah, so. But then we were like, okay, then web sockets. Yeah? But that's only 10 plus. And then we were, wrong calling. Back to the drawing board. But then we searched further, and it came with some cool module. And it's called PushKey. That's a guy called London Bear. I think he called the same. And he just built an Nginx module, incorporating all those push mechanisms in one module. So, and it has a built-in JavaScript library. So just, you can just pull out the JavaScript, and then it just tries whatever push mechanism you can deliver. So how do we do that? This is how we install it. It's really easy. I just did it in like 10 minutes, the whole thing, with this Wi-Fi. So you just get the source, do something with it. Also get an Nginx, untart, and just configure it with this module. And then make it, and at the last point, install, run it with the standard Nginx config of the module. That's some basic configuration of this module. So you have directly a push server at your will. And then how do we push?
Is there any alternative of this for Apache?
You don't want to use Apache. Yeah, I don't know. We were not looking for Apache, so I don't know if it's there for Apache. I hope maybe it is. If you can offload CPC, because if you start up a lot of processes with this kind of stuff, your server is going to die. So you need something right inside your server, just returning stuff without a lot of memory. And if Apache has something, I hope so for you then. So, but how do we push? Yeah, this is the basic push. You just register to a event source. Yeah, just now event source that's configured by the module. And then it's listening to that stream, and then you can just publish a message by hitting that URL. But yeah, maybe I should just show it to you. If this is still awesome. Okay. Yes, can we read that? RB? This is just the server running. Okay, so that's not interesting. And maybe I can change the color. So I could just do this. Okay, let's just hit that URL and keep it open. And so you get some headers. And standard Nginx is configured to give a ping every second. So you see all the minus ones. It's just the ping of the Nginx server.
Maybe you want me to the right?
Oh, it's... Not much more. Okay. Now I have here the other screen. Put it up. Oh. Yeah, but then you can see it only here, so that's not working out. Okay, so I just post a message to the same channel, that's called channels, with the message, hello, and look what happens. And now I kill it. So what you see is a JSON string that's also configurable in the settings of the module. And what it does, it returns what I push in the text parameter, and also the channel name. And that's really handy. I will show you later. But yeah, you have like an instant push. So yeah, it's really cool.
So this is something like WebSocket, but with better support from browser?
No, because Internet Explorer is totally not.
I know, but it's something similar, as I see.
Yeah, but this is one direction, so you cannot. This is only from server to client. Oh, and WebSocket is also client to server.
You can call it.
Yeah, but the main benefit of this is just over HTTP. So WebSocket, you have the difficult
WS, yes, yes,
and now it's just HTTP.
But how about server mode? With Nginx and this process, and when you open
this process is really small. So you have like a very small footprint to do this. So we have tested it on a normal server with 30,000 people.
30,000?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's really small. And the messages are also really small. It's like bytes. It's not kilobytes.
But this is a public stream, you will listen. You cannot separate, for example, to publish an event to one part of users and second part of users shouldn't receive it.
No, it's just who's registering to this stream gets the message.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's go on. So how did we implement this on our website? This is the basic JavaScript version of the push stream module. So you can get this from the examples. And what it does, it just creates a push stream object that has all the wrappers for the event sourcing and the WebSockets available. And you just say, I want to register on phpconf, and when something happens on phpconf, I want to call back in that function, and it just putting it in some HTML. But we did more because we had a lot of options on one web page. So how do you keep track of all those different channels in just one page without creating a lot of overhead? So we created this snippet of HTML defining all the different options and some countdown and whatever. And the main part is the UUID ID. It's just a normal ID string. And when we loaded the page, we grabbed all the class names with push action. And that's on top. So for each option div, we created a separate object doing some background stuff like updating the timer and the workplace. The bits should be shown. And we said to our auction manager, okay, add this auction to my list of auctions I want to track. And at the end, we just say connect. And it's just like the push stream connect. It just connects to all the channels at once. So one stream can connect to 100 channels. And then when we receive a message from the push stream, we just look it up, which channel was it, because you can get that from the JSON stream, and then we just update only that auction. with the data we need to put in. Yes.
So I have one question. How are you handling the security? Because
it's open.
It's open.
Yes. Not pushing, but getting the data. It's just open. Because it's just public. Sorry?
It's something like library access or something.
Yeah, it's like just like on the website. If you don't want to show it.
So from where it even comes?
So
from where it even comes? So are they having like
the bits. So if there's someone bits and where the data comes from, that's secure. That's behind everything. So you can configure the push stream to say I want the publish calls, this one. Mm-hmm. The publish calls only from the same server or from this kind of servers be handled. So if someone else, like here, tries to hit it, it just gives a 404. So that's the security. But subscribing to the stream is just public. Okay, so that was. Push stream, and it's really handy to do it right now. What we're now trying to implement are service workers. That's totally new. It's from Mozilla and Google. And what it is, it's someone knows the web workers. Web workers are background processes in pages. So when you load a page, you can offload some JavaScript to the background, and it just runs there, and normal page query is going on. But the main difference is web workers are document controlled. So if you move away from the document, your web worker is gone. But these service workers are event based, so it can run forever in your browser.
Isn't this like a security breach?
No, but because it's only running when you're in your environment.
Okay.
But they are still drafting also all the calls, and they have some issues also. But it should be secure, and it's only available for SQS. But if you want to try it, last week it's gone into the Chrome Canary build. You have to enable it even if you are in Chrome Canary. And it's in the Mozilla Nightly. But how does it work? You get something like this. You say, okay, my scope is hello. So every URL hit with hello is getting into the scope of this service worker. We register the service worker.js with the scope, and then when it's registered, we just do some console logging. And in the service worker below, we just set it on the event on fetch. So when one page is fetched, starting with hello, we just first get into this. So what we can do is, if we have this in our cache in the service worker, we can just say, okay, don't go to the server. You just load the whole page from your own browser cache, or do something else. We can redirect to other stuff or load other things. The cool thing is. Has anyone ever built a mobile app? A mobile app with push? You can also do that with this. You get an on push. And how this works is just basically the same as the mobile app. You register your browser to to a third party push service. And then when it's okay, the application, web application, gets the ID and the endpoint. And you have to store the ID on your server so you know which applications to push. And then when you push a message to your push servers, it will receive an on-push event in your browser. But the cool thing is, because the service worker can also run even if you don't are on your website. So it can show a notification even if you are not on the website. Okay, there are some new bits. There's still 1 minute left before ending your auction. Go now to the auction and bid. So that's really cool. But this is really new. It's not yet in. I think Internet Explorer won't support it because they're not building it.
Sorry.
But it's really cool to look into this because I think this is going to be huge, the service workers. And you can do a lot of great stuff with it. Also building caching, building databases, all in the background of your browser. And you can control it as a web developer. So, yeah, take a look at this. Don't blame me if it doesn't work for you, because it's new, it will change a lot. File some bugs if you find something in this, because they are building it right now. Just help them. So, this is my Twitter. You can find the draft specification on the GitHub. And this is the push module. Just use it. It's really easy. I just did it right there. There are a lot of examples also there of how to use it, what you can change. So yeah, that's it. If there are questions. This module is built into your Nginx, so your whole server will go down then.
So, yeah. It's not a bug, it's a feature.
So, yeah, but we are now using it in live environments. It's now, I think, 3 years old. Yeah, it's 2 years old. So it's fairly stable. It's open source, so if you find something, you can help them. But we didn't have any crash on this. We had crashes, but not on our push mechanism.
So you have to, let's say you have 10 servers, then one of them must have this engine's cross-stream module. So there will be this one particular place will be sent those messages, right? Let's say on your example with options, I don't think you have only one server to for this website, probably many more, and did you have where did you have this first three modules? On the one server or on
yeah. We have this on one server. The load is on our API servers and our backend servers because they are handling the heavy stuff. This is just giving out messages. So we have it's a big machine. I don't lie about it, but it handles all the messages.
How many of them? Roughly.
I think. We have like 10 options at the same time and with 600 people right now. So, yeah. And it's only pushing when we get something. Eh? So we have like 600 people connected. We tested it with 30,000. So we have even space to load it. Anyone else?
Will the presentation be available anywhere?
Yeah, I will upload it to all the places.
Okay.
Voici un chevet. It's a French. It's a French website.
I do want to ask this module and push it to the different servers.
Currently, we have one server for this. But as you can see, you can configure the URLs where it's connecting to. So basically, we can offload to whatever we want. So that's how we going to solve our load balancing problem. If we get, I hope so, then we have a big website.